Achtung Panzer, The Development of Tank Warfare by Heinz Guderian. Translated by Christopher Duffy. Introduction by Paul Harris. Read by Roger Davis. Editor's Introduction. Achtung Panzer is one of the most significant military books of the 20th century. Guderian distilled into it about 15 years' study of the development of mechanized warfare, from its origins in the First World War until 1937, the year the book was completed and published. He sought to demonstrate that only by the intelligent use of armoured formations could Germany achieve swift and decisive victories in future wars and avoid the ruinous attrition experienced in 1914 to 1918. Although a number of conservative senior officers were sceptical of Guderian's message, by the outbreak of the Second World War it had gained a good deal of acceptance. The Panzer, or armoured divisions, became the cutting edge of the German army in its spectacular victories of 1939 to 1942. Guderian was an outstanding soldier. A pioneer in the development of the German armoured forces, he later proved himself a dynamic and effective field commander, playing crucial roles in the Polish campaign, in the operation against France in May to June 1940, and in the attack on the Soviet Union in 1941. He was removed from field command in December 1941 after disputes with his superiors, and for about 15 months was unemployed before becoming inspector of panzer troops in March 1943. In July 1944, he became chief of the general staff, but was sent on indefinite leave in March 1945 after disagreements with Hitler. Although he was interrogated about war crimes, no serious evidence was found against him, and he was released without being indicted. He died in 1954. An English edition of Guderian's memoirs entitled Panzer Leader was published in 1952 and is one of the best-known German accounts of the Second World War. Yet Achtung Panzer, which explains the thinking behind the operations of the panzer forces and which served as a textbook for trainee panzer officers during the war, seems never to have been fully translated into English and has not been widely read outside Germany. Heinz Guderian was born in Kulm on the River Vistula in East Prussia in 1888. Military service was not a long-standing family tradition, but Heinz's father, Friedrich, himself an officer, decided on a military career for Heinz when the latter was still quite young. Guderian's secondary education was therefore in cadet schools specifically designed to prepare boys for entry to the officer corps. Guderian looked back with affection on his school years. Although the atmosphere was disciplined and conditions Spartan, he remembered his teachers as humane. The academic curriculum was very similar to that of the Realgymnasia, the leading German civilian secondary schools, consisting largely of modern languages, maths, and history. The standards were, Guderian insisted, equally high. A deep respect for education was a vital part of the Prusso-German military tradition, of which Guderian was an outstanding product. Particularly significant for the future development of Guderian's military thought were the linguistic abilities he began to acquire at school. He developed excellent French and good English. Knowledge of these languages, together with his native German, opened up to him much of the military literature of Europe. Achtung Panzer is an eclectic book in which Guderian selects with great discernment and synthesizes with great intelligence ideas drawn from a considerable range of sources. In February 1907, Guderian was sent as an ensign cadet, a trainee officer not yet commissioned, to the unit commanded by his father, the 10th Hanoverian Jäger Battalion. Jäger troops in the German army were the equivalent of the light infantry or rifle brigade troops in the British army, and their traditions encouraged rather more personal enterprise and initiative than those of ordinary infantry. After attending the war school at Metz from April to December 1907, he was commissioned into his battalion as a second lieutenant in January 1908. He married in 1913. Guderian was attached to a telegraph unit from October 1912 until September 1913 and served with signals for much of the First World War. During that war, he seems to have seen very little front-line service. He became a radio specialist and later a staff officer. An accurate understanding of the military possibilities of radio was very important for the development of Guderian's military thought. His staff training was even more significant for his future career. Guderian was proud to be a member of the German General Staff, the intellectual elite of the army, which formulated its doctrine and made its war plans. His memoirs are largely about his experience in the Second World War and tell us relatively little about his general staff education and training, but he does record that he was attached to the War Academy in Berlin, which was the general staff school from October 1913 until the outbreak of war. His general staff training was interrupted by the events of August 1914, and not formally completed until he attended a short course early in 1918. Achtung Panzer is in many ways a typical product of the thought processes developed by a German general staff education. A thorough grounding in German military history and the inculcation of the habit of detailed analysis of recent military operations in order to draw out lessons for the future were among its most important features. Contrary to a common opinion in the English-speaking countries, German military training at this highest level was not intended to produce robots, each programmed to think in exactly the same way. It was designed to develop and disseminate a common doctrine, which all officers could understand and implement. But students were also taught that doctrine must evolve in accordance with political and technical change. If they qualified as members of the general staff, they were expected to play a part in this evolutionary process. That, of course, was Guderian's purpose in Achtung Panzer. For a regular officer who had served throughout a world war, Guderian's career progression had been remarkably slow. He was still a captain in 1919. But his signals training and his general staff education were to stand him in good stead. The Treaty of Versailles, imposed on Germany by the Allies in 1919, theoretically abolished the German general staff, as well as banning the Germans from having tanks, submarines, and many other types of weapon. But the fact that Germany's enemies wanted to destroy it appears merely to have emphasized the importance of the general staff in the German military mind. It continued to exist under another name, being called the Truppenamt, the troop office, for most of the interwar period. One of the most significant years in his entire career was 1922, when General Chichwitz, the head of the motor transport troops, asked for a general staff-educated officer to help him consider the possible application of motor transport to a combat role. Chichwitz was empire building. The transport of food and ammunition was an important activity, but hardly glamorous. Chichwitz was seeking a more prestigious role for the forces he commanded. Germany still faced her usual problem of having potential enemies on widely separated fronts. It was possible that she might become involved in a war with France and Poland, or with France and Czechoslovakia. In the 1920s, the size of the German army was fixed by the Treaty of Versailles at a mere 100,000 men. It could not hope to gain a decisive victory in any such conflict. But by making the best use of its limited strength, it might stave off decisive defeat until the rest of the international community intervened to stop the war, perhaps under the aegis of the League of Nations. One way of doing this might be to employ a mobile operational reserve, which could strike a hard blow on one front and then move rapidly to mount a counterattack on the other. Motor transport would confer much greater flexibility on such a reserve than railways ever could. Having carefully studied the concept of motorized combat troops, Guderian came to the conclusion that it was not merely valid, but vital for the future of the army. Infantry mounted in trucks, however, would not be sufficient in themselves. They would need to be combined in fully motorized formations with the traditional supporting arms, artillery and engineers, and also with tanks. Although during the 1920s he became fascinated with them, Guderian had had no involvement with tanks in the First World War. Very few German officers had. Germany was slow to introduce tanks, not even starting to develop them until they had been used by the British on the Somme in September 1916, and giving them a very low priority, even when the British had demonstrated their potential at the Battle of Cambrai in November 1917. Even at the end of the war, so few German tanks had been manufactured that they were outnumbered by captured Allied tanks in frontline German units. Because tanks had been banned by the Treaty of Versailles, the Germans in the mid-20s had only a few experimental models, and these were being tested in the Soviet Union, by agreement with the Soviet government, in conditions of considerable secrecy. First-hand experience was therefore rather difficult to come by. But Guderian did not allow this to get in his way. He made personal contact with some of the relative handful of German tank veterans from the First World War and read everything he could lay his hands on about tanks. By 1937, his reading appears to have included British works by Swinton, Fuller and Martel, and a short book by an obscure French officer, one Charles de Gaulle. It says something for the broad-mindedness of the German army in the 1920s that Guderian was officially acknowledged as a leading expert on tank tactics years before he first set foot in a tank. Already in the 20s, there were tanks available in foreign countries, notably the British Vickers Medium, which were fast enough and had long enough ranges to be considered not merely of tactical, but potentially of operational significance. Guderian came to the conclusion that when tanks were incorporated in mechanized formations with infantry, artillery and engineers in correct proportion, when several of these formations were available and when they were used together for concentrated blows, they might determine the course of campaigns. This was Guderian's crucial insight, and he claims to have made it by the beginning of the 1930s. From then on until the outbreak of the Second World War, it was with the creation of motorized combat units and formations, and with the development of a doctrine for their use, that Guderian was principally concerned. Teaching and writing absorbed a good deal of Guderian's time in the 1920s. Teaching military history and tactics to transport corps officers destined for staff work was Guderian's main official duty in the period from October 1924 to October 1927. The officers he taught proved stimulating and demanding audiences. Guderian seems to have gained a considerable reputation as a teacher, and when he was transferred to the Transport Department of the War Ministry in October 1927, he was concurrently employed as a lecturer on tank tactics to the motor transport instructional staff, an activity which he seems to have kept up until 1930. From 1924 to 1935, he also contributed many articles to the military press, especially the Militär Wochenblatt, Military Weekly, whose editor, General Altrock, gave him a great deal of encouragement. Writing and teaching, together with wargaming, seem to have played an important part, not only in the dissemination, but also in the evolution of Guderian's military thought. In 1929, Guderian encountered real tanks for the first time. On a trip to Sweden, he was given hospitality by a Swedish tank battalion, which permitted him to learn to drive one of their M21 tanks. These machines were a version of the LK2, which had been developed by the German army in the First World War but had not seen active service before the war ended. Some of them had then been sold to Sweden. The M21 was a not particularly well-designed vehicle, and by 1929 it was obsolete. Nevertheless, Guderian records that he found his Swedish visit instructive. Having at last gained some hands-on experience, however limited, must have boosted his confidence and enhanced the conviction with which he taught and wrote about tank operations. In February 1930, Guderian, at the suggestion of his friend Colonel Lutz, who had become chief of staff to the Inspectorate of Transport Troops, took command of the 3rd Prussian Motor Transport Battalion. This battalion was being trained as a motorised combat unit and was equipped with some real armoured cars and motorcycles and with dummy tanks and anti-tank guns. The unit was involved in occasional exercises in which it attempted to demonstrate the utility of mechanised units to the rest of the army. But generally, Guderian received little encouragement from his superior, General Otto von Stultnagel, the inspector of the transport troops. According to Guderian, this officer expressed the opinion that neither of us will ever see German tanks in operation in our lifetime. Fortunately, from Guderian's point of view, Stulpnagel retired in 1931, and even more fortunately, he was succeeded by Lutz. In October 1931, Guderian became Lutz's chief of staff. The Lutz-Guderian partnership seems to have been absolutely vital to the development of the German mechanized forces in the critical period up to the establishment of the first 3 panzer divisions in October 1935. Although Lutz was the more senior officer, Guderian is usually regarded as having been the intellectual driving force. One area in which Guderian's influence proved to be of considerable importance was communications, the key to command and control. Enormous effort was dedicated to providing tanks with effective radio sets. By the outbreak of war, every German tank had at least a radio receiver, and every command tank had a transmitter also. This was a much better provision than that in any other army at this time, and it gave the German armoured formations an extremely high degree of tactical flexibility. By the time Hitler became Chancellor in January 1933, the military concepts on which the Panzertruppen, the armoured forces, were based, had been quite clearly formulated by Guderian and Lutz. There was nothing distinctively Nazi, therefore, about the Panzer divisions or the style of warfare which they helped to make possible. Yet Germany had a mere handful of real tanks when Hitler came to power, and most training was done with canvas dummies. The extraordinary growth of the Panzer arm from then until 1940 was owing to the overriding priority which Hitler gave to Germany's rearmament, helped to some degree by his personal enthusiasm for modern technology and particularly for the internal combustion engine. This enthusiasm is well illustrated by an incident which took place at the tank proving grounds at Kummersdorf in, according to most authorities, early 1934. After witnessing a demonstration of motorised troops, including most of the basic elements which were later to compose the Panzer divisions, Hitler is reported to have exclaimed, "That's what I need. That's what I want to have." Yet the Panzer forces never gained an overriding priority. Lutz and Guderian were forced to compete fiercely for resources with the other arms. The Panzer divisions formed only a small proportion of the German army when the Second World War began, and they remained so throughout its course. From October 1931 to October 1935, Guderian, as Lutz's chief of staff, had been at the very heart of affairs. First, at the Inspectorate of Motorised Troops in the Defence Ministry, and, from the 1st of July 1934, at the new Armoured Troops Command. When the first 3 Panzer divisions were established, however, Guderian was given command of 2nd Panzer Division based at Würzburg, an appointment which physically removed him from the centre of policy making. He was replaced as Lutz's chief of staff by Colonel Paulus, who, as a field marshal, was later to be captured by the Russians at Stalingrad. Lutz remained Guderian's immediate superior, however, and it was on Lutz's instructions that, in the winter of 1936 to 1937, he wrote Achtung Panzer. At that time, Lutz and Guderian seemed to have believed that there were still major intellectual and institutional battles to be fought before the Panzer troops could be assured of their rightful share of the resources devoted to Germany's rearmament. While some of the most senior officers in the army were generally supportive of the work that Lutz and Guderian were doing, there was still considerable scepticism among others. Guderian regarded Colonel General Beck, chief of the General Staff 1933 to 1938, as a major obstacle to progress. Beck was of a somewhat cautious and conservative disposition, and though by no means opposed to the use of tanks, had somewhat different views from Guderian on their distribution and employment. One development of the second half of the 1930s which particularly worried Guderian, and which was partly attributable to Beck, was the raising of tank brigades for close cooperation with infantry divisions. Another was the formation, at the instigation of the cavalry, of so-called light divisions, mechanized divisions consisting largely of cavalry personnel, which were primarily designed for reconnaissance and screening, the main cavalry roles of the late 19th century. The motorization of four infantry divisions also dismayed him. These developments seemed to Guderian to dissipate, in a potentially ruinous way, the German army's assets in tanks and other motor vehicles. Given how very limited these resources were, Guderian believed that they should be concentrated almost exclusively in the panzer divisions. He thought the infantry divisions should continue to move on foot and rely on horses to draw their transport and artillery. The light divisions, while tying up some tanks and a lot of motor transport, lacked offensive power and would be of little use. The employment of tanks merely in support of unmechanized infantry was a reversion to the practice of 1916 to 1918. Tanks in this role might have some limited tactical utility, but could have no operational impact. Guderian informs us that Lutz instructed him to write Achtung Panzer in order to gain the widest possible publicity for the cause of the Panzer divisions. It is thus very much a tract for the times, intended to score points off institutional opponents and to gain the maximum resources for Guderian's own branch of the army. Given this polemical purpose, and given that Guderian wrote it in just a few months while commanding a division, the listener may well be surprised at how serious and substantial a treatise Achtung Panzer turned out to be. By 1936, Guderian had been immersed in the study of mechanized warfare for so long that it was probably all but impossible for him to produce a glib piece of mere propaganda, even if that were all Lutz required of him. Achtung Panzer is a work of theory which was intended to help Germany prepare for the warfare of the immediate future. But it is also a work of history. More than half the book is devoted to a rigorous analysis of the experience of the Western Front in the First World War. The emphasis is on the factors which brought the tank into existence, the technical development of tanks, the organizational development of tank corps, and the actual experience of tank operations. Guderian's historical analysis is remarkable for its lack of national chauvinism. Inevitably, he praises the British and French for being the front runners in tank development and deprecates Germany's tardiness in producing tanks of her own. But his frankness goes beyond that. It had suited the Nazis to claim that the German army had not been defeated in the field, but stabbed in the back by Jews and socialists. But as part of his advocacy of the importance of the tank, Guderian openly admits that the German army was conclusively defeated on the Western Front, the one theatre of operations in which tanks were employed in substantial numbers. It assists his thesis to point out that the negotiations leading to the armistice were sought, on the insistence of Ludendorff, the army's supreme commander, as a direct result of the shock administered at Amiens on the 8th of August 1918 by a British offensive led by 400 tanks, and he makes this point too without equivocation. Guderian's account of military developments in the First World War and of the role of the tank in that war can be criticised in some particulars. Many of the works he consulted were written by actors in the drama and cannot be regarded as objective. Using Major General Swinton's memoirs, Eyewitness, as one of his main sources, it is arguable that he somewhat overrates Swinton's part in the development of the tank. Perhaps because of the hurry in which he worked, his account is occasionally slightly garbled. He gives Winston Churchill credit for the suggestion of using the Holt caterpillar tractor as the basis for a trench-crossing machine, whereas Churchill, for all his drive and imagination, lacked the technical knowledge to make this suggestion, and in fact the Holt system played virtually no part in the development of British tanks. Guderian relies largely on authors who were leading tank advocates, and most present-day military historians would argue that the capacity of the tank to influence events on the Western Front was much more marginal, even in 1918, than Guderian suggests. But these points matter little. Guderian was not writing primarily for an academic readership. What was significant to him was to understand the events of the recent past accurately enough to draw the correct military lessons for the future. Guderian was right in that, as a force in European war, cavalry was in terminal decline. He was also right to emphasise the enormous advantages that lay with the defender and the acute weakness of infantry in the offensive, a weakness that even massive artillery support had proved inadequate to offset. Perhaps Guderian does not give the German infantry sufficient credit for the great tactical strides which they made between 1914 and 1918. Stormtroops and the infiltration tactics which played such a crucial role in the initially successful German offensives of spring 1918 are hinted at but not actually mentioned. Yet he was essentially correct that without mechanical assistance, even the German infantry of 1918 could achieve breakthrough only at very great cost. It had proved quite incapable of the rapid exploitation necessary to convert mere tactical victories into decisive operational success. From his detailed accounts of all the main tank actions of the First World War, Guderian explicitly draws the following lessons. A. Tanks are of little use when penny-packeted and should be massed. B. They should not be wasted on unsuitable ground, as they were by the British GHQ in the swamps of Ypres, but saved for use on good going. C. That the greatest results can be achieved when massed tanks are used with the benefit of surprise. These were lessons which Ernest Swinton, J.F.C. Fuller and Giffard Le Ken Martel had been trying to drive home in the British Army from 1916 onwards. They were by no means original to Guderian, but the ability to learn from enemies is a military virtue, and the lessons were no less valid for being acquired from the writings of British officers. Although he does not devote a very great deal of space to it, Guderian is also extremely perceptive in his discussion of the role of air power. He points out that the importance of military aviation greatly increased during the course of the war, and that by 1918 the Germans were operating in the face of a substantial Allied air superiority. He is not impressed with the effectiveness of Allied air attack on the German homeland, but stresses the impact of aircraft on operations on the Western Front. In what may be regarded as one of the most significant paragraphs in the book, he explains that Allied aircraft in 1918 created disorder in the German rear areas, hindered the movement of reserves, and brought German batteries under actual attack. All of this was of material influence on the course of the ground fighting, especially when they were acting in coordination with tanks. Aircraft became an offensive weapon of the first order, distinguished by their great speed, range, and effect on target, he records. In the second half of the book, Guderian is concerned with post-war military developments, especially in armoured fighting vehicle design and in the organisation of mechanised formations. Even here, his approach is largely historical. He first records what has already happened and only then prescribes for the future. It is all very pragmatic. There is no abstract theorising. The developments Guderian suggests in military organisation and in the conduct of operations are no more than logical projections of trends he had observed in the First World War, making allowance for technological change. Guderian argues that it is ridiculous to waste the potential afforded by the much greater speeds of which tanks have become capable since the First World War by tying them to the pace of the infantry divisions. Tanks should therefore be concentrated in formations designed to exploit their potential, formations capable of both breakthrough and exploitation. Yet he does not argue that tanks can achieve much on their own. Armoured formations, he argues, must be large and must include other arms, including infantry and artillery. The ideal solution, he indicates, is for the artillery to be self-propelled and for the infantry to be mounted in armoured carriers with roughly the same mobility characteristics as the tank. In fact, at the time he was writing, the Panzer Division's artillery was largely towed, and there were no armoured carriers for their infantry component. As Guderian explains, the infantry of the Panzer Divisions were having to make do with motorcycles and trucks for mobility. The decision to commit the armoured divisions, he maintains, must lie with the High Command. He insists that they should always be deployed in both breadth and depth, and used en masse. In a particularly perceptive and telling sentence, he argues that concentration of the available armoured forces will always be more effective than dispersing them, irrespective of whether we are talking about a defensive or offensive posture, a breakthrough or an envelopment, a pursuit or a counterattack. Guderian regarded the breakthrough battle as presenting great difficulties. The First World War had shown the inherent strength of the defence in an age of magazine rifles, machine guns, and quick-firing artillery. To smash through a well-prepared defence, Guderian believed that it would be necessary to bring the whole depth of the enemy position under attack simultaneously. In this context, he argues that air power will have a crucial part to play in support of the Panzer divisions. He writes, "Success is probably attainable only when the entire defensive system can be brought under attack at more or less the same time. When the attack begins, the enemy hinterland must be subjected to vigilant aerial surveillance so as to identify the movements of the enemy reserves and direct our combat aircraft against them. The air forces must bend their efforts to preventing, or at least delaying, the flow of those reserves to the location of the breakthrough." There are strong echoes here of the deep battle ideas of Soviet military thinkers, such as Triantafilov and Tukhachevsky. Indeed, in the section of the book dealing with the development of armoured forces in Russia, Guderian shows some familiarity with deep battle theory. He mentions neither Tukhachevsky nor Triantafilov, but does refer to and quote Krishanovsky, a lesser-known member of the same school. Listeners will notice that nowhere does Guderian use the term blitzkrieg, often thought to encapsulate the German approach to war in the Nazi era. In fact, the term seems not to have been used in Germany before the Second World War, when it was picked up from the foreign press. Its first known use occurs in a 1939 article on the Polish campaign in the American Time magazine. It conjures up rather well the image of a fast-moving campaign, but is no more than a journalist's buzzword, devoid of precise meaning. It never became part of the official German military vocabulary. For a British historian, one of the most striking things about Achtung Panzer is Guderian's devotion of so much space to British military ideas and innovations. Guderian was, after all, a member of the German General Staff, one of the greatest institutions ever created for solving the problems of large-scale land warfare. It is remarkable, therefore, that he draws so much inspiration from an island nation, generally much less adapted to this type of conflict than the Germans. There is, however, no doubt that up to the end of the 1920s, while tanks were banned in Germany, the British led the world not only in the technical development of fighting vehicles, but also in the organisation and handling of armoured formations. Guderian was obviously fascinated by the British General Staff's pioneering work with the Experimental Mechanical Force, established in 1927. He also took an interest in the Experimental Tank Brigade of 1931 and the Mobile Force Exercise of 1934. The British appeared to Guderian to be much more interested than the French in the operations of mechanised formations deep in the enemy's rear. He freely acknowledges that, up to the early 30s, the Germans were using a translation of a British General Staff booklet as their own manual on mechanised warfare. Sadly, by the end of the decade, the British had fallen badly behind the Germans in this field. On the subject of British influence, some listeners will be surprised that there is not more reference to Basil Liddell Hart, the famous military journalist and author. He is mentioned only once in connection with the Experimental Mechanical Force of 1927. Since the late 1970s, military historians specialising in this period have been aware that the well-known passage in Guderian's memoirs, in which Liddell Hart is extolled above all others as the inspiration behind the early victories of the Panzer forces, was put there at Liddell Hart's own request at a time when Guderian was in various ways indebted to him. Significantly, this passage does not occur in the original German edition. While British books figure prominently in the bibliography of Achtung Panzer, there is none among them by Liddell Hart, and nothing in the text to indicate that Liddell Hart had any marked influence on the development of Guderian's thought. The part of Achtung Panzer dealing with Russia now seems particularly prophetic. Guderian credited the Russians with having 10,000 tanks, and was obviously impressed with the seriousness with which they approached the business of mechanised warfare. He finishes his discussion of the Soviet Union with a terrible warning. Russia possesses the strongest army in the world, both in numerical terms and in terms of the modernity of its weapons and equipment. The Russians have the world's largest air force as well. Russia has ample raw materials, and a mighty armaments industry has been set up in the depths of that vast empire. The time has passed when the Russians had no feeling for technology. We will have to reckon on the Russians being able to master and build their own machines, and with the fact that such a transformation in the Russians' fundamental mentality presents us with the Eastern question in a form more serious than ever before in history. Confronted with the evidence of this passage, we probably ought to believe Guderian when he tells us that he was horrified at the prospect of invading the Soviet Union and wrote a memorandum to the High Command opposing Operation Barbarossa. On a personal level, Achtung Panzer was a great success for Guderian. The book became a bestseller, the proceeds from which bought him his first car. It is impossible to tell to what extent its publication assisted the Panzer forces in the battle for resources within the German army. Probably its impact was only marginal. Yet the Panzer forces developed impressively in the late 30s. Only three Panzer divisions were established in October 1935, but by the outbreak of war there were six. In the Polish campaign, the light divisions, established at the instigation of the cavalry lobby, were found, as Guderian had predicted, to lack sufficient offensive power, and all four were converted to panzer divisions. Thus, there were 10 panzer divisions available for the attack on France in May to June 1940, their most dramatic victory. As they approach the end of their task, the editors are more than ever convinced of the importance of Guderian as a military thinker. It is probably not going too far to say that Achtung Panzer is essential listening for anyone who wishes to understand the development of land warfare in the 20th century. The appearance of an English edition is surely long overdue. Preface by General de Panzertruppen Lutz. If the fundamental principles of combat are identical for all arms of service, their application is strongly conditioned by the technical means that are available. Even now, opinions are sharply divided concerning the employment and operation of tanks. This should occasion no surprise, since all armies are burdened by a strong, if not limitless, power of inertia. The lessons of the World War point without exception to the importance of concentrating large masses of tanks on the decisive spot, a practice which also happens to correspond with the principle of forming a principal axis of effort, Schwerpunktbildung. To many observers, however, the experiences of the war fail to offer convincing guidelines, and not least because the means available to the defence have shown a quantitative and qualitative improvement in the intervening years. One thing remains clear, that every technical means of combat, tanks included, must be developed to the farthest limit of its potential. It follows that we should not restrict our opportunities out of a regard for tradition. On the contrary, we must take our lead from the new weapons in question. What we carry from the past must be developed farther and, if necessary, changed by the possibilities which now lie before us. With these considerations in mind, I express the hope that the present book will contribute to the clarification of our thinking. General de Panzertruppen Lutz. Introduction. We live in a world that is ringing with the clangor of weapons. Mankind is arming on all sides, and it will go ill with a state that is unable or unwilling to rely on its own strength. Some nations are fortunate enough to be favoured by nature. Their borders are strong, affording them complete or partial protection against hostile invasion through chains of mountains or wide expanses of sea. By way of contrast, the existence of other nations is inherently insecure. Their living space is small and in all likelihood ringed by borders that are predominantly open, and lie under constant threat from an accumulation of neighbours who combine an unstable temperament with armed superiority. Some powers may have considerable natural resources and colonial territories at their disposal, and derive therefrom a considerable degree of independence both in war and peace. Others, who are no less viable and may indeed often be larger in terms of population, will possess a very restricted base of raw materials and few, if any, colonial territories. Because of this, they live in a state of continual economic stress and are in no position to sustain a long war. The pattern of historical development, together with the lack of insight on the part of nations who live in a state of superiority, have created a condition of crisis for those nations who are unable to tolerate a long period of hostilities with all its attendant economic privations. Such nations have been forced to consider what means may best conduce to bring an armed conflict to a rapid and tolerable end. If we are impelled to throw ourselves into this debate, it is because we remember all too vividly the state of famine that was occasioned in the Central Powers by the war and by the blockade which so cruelly prolonged beyond the armistice. Leaving aside other mistakes on the part of the political and military leadership, we must recognise that in 1914 the offensive power of our army was not sufficient to bring about a rapid peace. That is to say that our armament, equipment and organisation did not permit us to pose a material equivalent to the enemy's numerical superiority. We believed that we possessed a moral superiority of our own, and indeed we were probably right. But this superiority was not enough to win the day. The moral and intellectual condition of a nation may certainly prove of decisive importance on its own account, but all due attention must also be paid to material considerations. When a nation has to reckon with a struggle against superior forces on several fronts, it must neglect nothing that may conduce to the betterment of its situation. All of this may appear self-evident, but military literature is replete with statements that indicate that many people believe that we may embark on a new war with the weapons of 1914, or at best, with those available in 1918. Many authorities consider themselves forward-looking when they bring themselves to admit the value of the new weapons which appeared towards the end of the war as auxiliaries of the old ones. This is a narrowing and negative concept. Fundamentally, these men are unable to break free of the memories of positional warfare, which they persist in viewing as the form of combat of the future, and they are incapable of summoning up the necessary act of will to stake everything on a rapid decision. In particular, they are blind to the prospects that are opened up by a full exploitation of the internal combustion engine. It is a love of comfort, not to say sluggishness, that characterizes those who protest against revolutionary innovations that happen to demand fresh efforts in the way of intellect, physical striving, and resolution. Hence, we encounter the outright assertion that motorized and mechanized weapons represent nothing revolutionary or new, and dismissive comments on the lines that their single chance of success came and went in 1918, that they have had their day, and that one may content oneself with standing on the defensive. We could cite other statements, equally smug and negative, but the facts speak otherwise. One thing is certain, the replacement of muscle power by this new machine will lead to one of the mightiest technical and therefore economic transformations that the world has ever seen. Far from being at the summit of these developments, I believe we are only at the beginning. Adolf Hitler at the opening of the Automobile Exhibition, 1937. Such revolutionary economic changes must lead, as always, to military changes of a corresponding order. It is a question of making sure that military developments keep pace with the technical and economic ones. This is only possible if we welcome the developments in question wholeheartedly and not just pay lip service to them. Such a wholehearted affirmation, which is a precondition of promoting these developments, demands that we should assess the actual effect of weapons in the last war, beginning with the weapons and arms of service which took the field in 1914 and proceeding to those, most of them unfortunately wielded by the enemy, with which we had to reckon in 1918. We next have to survey the developments that took place in foreign countries while we ourselves laboured under the restrictions imposed by the Versailles Diktat, the Treaty of Versailles. And finally, we must use our investigations as a means of drawing conclusions for the future. This book does not set out to present a history of the technical development of tanks. Such a work would demand a specialized and comprehensive treatment by expert authorities. I touch on the technical unfolding of this new weapon only as far as seems necessary to explain the course of military events. In this volume, I am striving very much more to describe the development of the tank arm from the viewpoint of the soldiers who must wield it. My work is therefore concerned chiefly with combat tactics and the operational exploitation of tactical success. If the tactical lessons are drawn from the events on the Western Front between 1914 and 1918, it is because that theatre was where the main decision of the war was reached, and where our strongest enemies and we ourselves deployed the most potent and the most modern means of combat. It was here that these weapons made their first appearance in warfare, and it is with them that we must chiefly reckon in the future. The reliability and comprehensiveness of the sources concerning these weapons leave, unfortunately, a great deal to be desired, and they make the task of impartial assessment all the more difficult. 20 years have passed since these devices made their debut, and it is high time that official historiography got down to describing how they performed. Until that time, we will have to make do with unofficial researches that have been conducted under difficult conditions and which are riddled with lacunae. My aim in this book is to inspire veterans and young soldiers alike to reflect on these matters, to look into them more deeply and then proceed to purposeful action. I hope also that the work will convey to our able-bodied youth an image of our Panzer forces and teach them how to master the technical achievements of the present age and put them at the service of the fatherland. Chapter 1. 1914. How did positional warfare come about? Part 1. Lances against machine guns. The August sun shone down mercilessly on the low rolling country as it stretched from the northwest bank of the Meuse at Liège westwards in the general direction of Brussels. Between the 5th and the 8th of August, 2nd and 4th Cavalry Divisions under General von der Marwitz crossed the Meuse at Liège on the Dutch-Belgian border, and on the 10th of August encountered numbers of the enemy, who were dug in east and southwest of Tilmont. The Germans decided to outflank them to the north, and the two divisions were temporarily disengaged and pulled back on the 11th of August to the area east of Saint-Trond, where they rested. The exertions of these first days of the campaign were extremely demanding, and as early as the 6th of August, the Germans began to run alarmingly short of oats for their horses. The earlier probing actions had established that the Belgian troops had withdrawn from Ligne en Tirlemont, and that the Belgian army would not deploy for action in front of the line Louvain-Namur. Strong forces and fieldworks were identified behind the line of the jet, running from Diest through Tirlemont to Jeudogne. From Tirlemont downstream, the jet itself formed an obstacle in its own right, and was augmented by the wet water meadows and a number of drainage ditches. North of Haarlem, they emptied into the Diemen, which flowed from the east by way of Hasselt. Downstream from that location, the Diemen measured 10 metres wide by 2 metres deep. Visibility was restricted by rows of trees and hedges, and many of the built-up areas and fields were divided by wire fences. North of the Diemen, a canal, again 10 metres wide by 2 metres deep, ran almost due north from Hasselt to Turnhout, where the greater and lesser Niete flowed into the mighty, fortified city port of Antwerp on the Scheldt. Altogether, the terrain and the way it had been developed posed considerable difficulties in the path of cavalry when it was advancing along the roads. These difficulties became downright intolerable as soon as the Germans tried to make their way cross-country on horseback. On the 12th of August, General von der Marwitz sought to outflank the defended sector of the jet by a move northwards in the direction of Diest. With this intention, he set 2nd Cavalry Division in motion by way of Hasselt, and 4th Cavalry Division, reinforced by 9th Jäger Battalion and the Cycle Company of 7th Jäger Battalion, by way of Ulken and Stevort to Haarlem, while reconnaissance patrols crossed an imaginary line running from Hechtel to Tirlemont by way of Beringen and Diest. 10th Cavalry Brigade of 4th Cavalry Division remained at Saint-Trond to protect the left flank, with a reconnaissance squadron posted further southwest at Landen. 2nd Cavalry Division seized a number of weapons in Hasselt, and after some delay it marched at about noon to Stevort on the Haarlem Road. 4th Cavalry Division had already arrived at the same location, which meant that both divisions were now formed up in line ahead on a road which lay uncomfortably close to the enemy front. During the march, General von der Mawitz ordered 4th Cavalry Division to open the passage of the jet at Haarlem, with 2nd Cavalry Division taking the lead by pushing to Erc-la-Ville and securing the ground northwards in the direction of Lummen. The patrols reported that the crossing at Haarlem was held by the enemy, and General von Garnier accordingly brought his artillery into position west of Erc-la-Ville, while he deployed the reinforced 9th Jäger Battalion on both sides of the Haarlem Road, and set 3 Cavalry Brigade the task of outflanking the enemy to the south. Towards 1300, the Jägers seized the damaged bridge over the Jetta and penetrated to the western end of the village of Haarlem. It was now that the enemy artillery opened up, setting buildings ablaze, sweeping the village street from end to end, and inflicting the first German casualties. The Germans now recognized that the heights west of Haarlem were occupied by the enemy. Meanwhile, 3 Cavalry Brigade, 2nd Cuirassier Regiment and 9th Uhlan Regiment, with the help of their pontoon wagons, had made a passage of the Jetta at Donk, south of Haarlem, and were in the process of crossing the river. 17 Cavalry Brigade, 17th and 18th Dragoon Regiments, had moved up immediately east of Haarlem, and had designated 4th Squadron of the latter regiment as the reconnaissance squadron, and sent it in the direction of the infantry who were deployed and in action on the Haarlem-Diest Railway, and the enemy artillery which had been identified at Houtem. Our own artillery, which so far had given effective support to the attack on Haarlem, now had to change position to accompany the advance. The intended battery sites, which were just west of Haarlem, had first to be captured, and this mission was given to 17th Dragoons, who were following immediately behind 4th Reconnaissance Squadron of the 18th. One event now overtook another with dramatic urgency. 4th Squadron at once headed westwards through Haarlem in column of fours with the intention of carrying out the reconnaissance as had just been ordered. 17th Dragoons came up behind through the village in the same formation as a preliminary to exploiting the road which ran northwest towards Diest. Its 2 leading squadrons and the staff of the headquarters, meanwhile, remained in column of fours along the road, since the hedges and fences prohibited any kind of deployment. 3rd Squadron got entangled in wire fences and difficult country west of the road. The direction of the German cavalry was betrayed by a mighty cloud of dust, and Belgian skirmishers, machine guns and batteries now opened a concentrated fire against the squadrons as they galloped from Haarlem in their closed columns. The effect was devastating. Afterwards, the remnant of the German cavalry was assembled at the western edge of Haarlem, or just to the south of the village, while individual dragoons, who had lost their horses, kept up the fight alongside the Jägers. Meanwhile, our artillery had been able to take up position west of Haarlem and opened fire on the enemy batteries at Houtem. The Germans hoped to hold down the Belgian artillery fire sufficiently to permit 18th Dragoons to pass through Haarlem in their turn, and then, debouching by the exit which led southwest towards Velpen, spur on against the heights. The deployment from column of twos had to be accomplished under a hail of rifle and machine gun fire. With standards flying, the Germans moved into attack formation, with two squadrons making up the first line and the third in echelon to the left rear, and in the process the horsemen rolled over the foremost lines of the enemy skirmishers. Then, however, the attack was shattered by an outburst of violent defensive fire among a zone of hedges and barbed wire fences. The German losses were extremely heavy. While these events were unfolding, Three Cavalry Brigade met its own fate. The brigade had made a successful passage of the Jet at Donk, and it was there that it received the order to sweep onwards and capture the enemy artillery. Without losing a moment, the regiment of Kernighan Cuirassiers galloped through Velpen with a first line of three squadrons. This charge, too, was beaten off with severe losses. The regimental commander renewed the attack with the third squadron, which was still intact, and the remnants of the first two squadrons. It was all in vain, and a third and last effort proved to be no more successful. Just to the right of the cuirassiers, 9th Uhlan Regiment was attacking in the direction of Tuileries Ferme, with two squadrons in its first line and two in the second. After the first line collapsed, the second took up the attack, only to meet the same fate. After the failure of the cavalry assault, the push was continued in the direction of Houghton by the Jägers, who from 1400 had the support of skirmishers from the Leibhusaren Brigade, who had dismounted for combat on foot. The Germans took Liebruck to the north and Velpen to the south. However, the fact remains that for the first time in the war, an attempt had been made to charge modern weapons with cold steel, and the effort had miscarried. What had the enemy been doing? From 0500 on the 10th of August, the Belgian cavalry division had been positioned behind the Jetta between Bunningen and Diest, with the purpose of holding that sector and pushing reconnaissance patrols in the direction of Tongres, Beringen and Kwaadmechelen. The villages of Budingen, Gietbetz and Haarlem had been put in a state of defence, and all the bridges over the Jetta had been destroyed, except for the two at Haarlem and Zelk, and these had been prepared for demolition. Enemy cavalry patrols had been beaten off. On the morning of the 12th of August, strong forces of German cavalry were detected on the march for Hasselt. A request for reinforcements was accordingly made to the Belgian High Command, whereupon 4th Infantry Brigade was put at the disposal of the cavalry division and had set out in the direction of Korteneken at 0815 on the day of the battle. Without pausing for rest, the leading reinforcements accomplished a forced march of 21 kilometres in crushing heat, and at 1600 they arrived on the scene of action in the form of four weak battalions of infantry and a battery of artillery. This battery was the first element of the Belgian forces to arrive, and after planting itself at Loxbergen, it had taken up the duel with the German batteries. By 1600, most of the reserves had been fed into the infantry fight. After his 4th Infantry Brigade had arrived, the Belgian divisional commander, General de Witte, resolved on a counter-attack against Haarlem on both sides of the Jetta. The assault was broken at Velpen by the fire of the German Jägers, machine guns, the Leibhusaren and the artillery. Towards 1830, General von der Marwitz broke off the action and assembled his forces east of the Jetta. Four German cavalry regiments had taken part in the attack, and their losses amounted to 24 officers, 468 men, and 843 horses. Total Belgian losses came to 10 officers, 117 men, and 100 horses. What is notable about the action at Haarlem? It represents a commitment of cavalry in considerable force, if not simultaneously, against defending infantry and artillery. We see essentially the same outcome in the larger attacks which were launched in the face of enemy fire on the other fronts, such as those of the Bavarian Uhlan Brigade at Lagarde on the 11th of August 1914, or the 13th Dragoon Regiment at Borzimi on the 12th of November. This indicates that the example of Haarlem holds true for many other actions. The original task of General von der Marwitz had been to advance against the line Antwerp-Brussels-Charleroi so as to pin down the Belgian, British and French forces in Belgium. Nowadays, it is fair to pose the question why von der Marwitz, once the Belgians had been identified behind the Jetta south of Diest, did not attempt to strike out north of the Diemer. If he had succeeded in...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.